Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm honored to be here this morning. And this presentation was jointly prepared by Mr. Sanjay Viendran from European Space Agency. He's lead of Solaris program at ESA. And myself, I'm program manager for Advanced Exploration Program at Thales Alenia Space here in Torino. So this presentation introduces, as Stefan said, the space-based solar power concept. And I take advantage from this program to point out what are the implications of its delivery to space and the human-robot collaboration required to do this kind of operation. So, let me start with what is the biggest issues of today and tomorrow. Will be the climate crisis and the need for energy security in Europe. Space-based solar power is a capability that can address both of these simultaneously, providing a new element for in the toolbox of energy solution for future. The question we would like to address for this concept are, could space solar power help Europe and the world to become more sustainable? Or could it be a game changer? Or not just for terrestrial energy, but also for ambition in space? As a major source of global emission, the energy sector holds the key for responding to the world climate challenge. The energy transition and the net zero is a huge challenge for which today there are no clear pathway to achieving it with existing clean energy generation technologies. All the element terrestrial, solar, photovoltaic, wind, hydro, nuclear, all have their place in a sustainable energy mix. But also their limitation, for example, intermittency, reliability, geographic availability, scalability, land use, operational safety, waste, last but not least. And the question is, how could space help to close the gap in clean energy the world needs? The space-based solar power offers an energy source that is clean, continuously available, potentially 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 375 days a year. Therefore, complementary to intermittent renewable like ground solar and wind. It's scalable for future European needs. It's available to all countries, largely independent of geography. It's free of hazardous waste. It's technologically achievable within 10-15 years of start of development with sufficient investment. We will see then what is the path for achieving this goal. So, the main concept for getting energy for sun are now under analysis for the consortium led by Thales Alenia Space and other are under analysis for capturing solar power in space and we are assessing now the best solution for proposing the development of this concept in the future. This one described in this slide is that the same process used on Earth to convert sunlight into electricity through photovoltaic panel. But in this case, photovoltaic panel are in space and they capture solar energy, convert it into radio wave, and beam beam it down to Earth, where dedicated direct antennas convert energy transmitted by radio wave into electricity. Another concept is another approach. It's based on increasing sunlight on photovoltaic panels on Earth by redirecting the solar light via reflection panel on satellite. Advantages in this case is that sunlight beamed down to Earth is not subject to day-night alternation and can be potentially always available. This kind of artificial sun can be powered up, dimmed, could be shut down on demand. This approach is simpler with respect to the one I showed in the previous chart, but it has benefit and is useful in some specific cases. It can be realized in shorter time. What will this take to realize? Okay, the potential architecture we are considering, just to explain how this system works. This one is based on SPS Alpha, for which Mr. John Mankins is one of the father. In this case, a solar power satellite in geostationary orbit capture solar power that is converted into radio wave that are transmitted to ground station to rectenna on Earth. In this case, the solution is expected to be collocated in geostationary orbit 36,000 kilometers far from Earth. We suppose it's able to generate 2 kilowatts into grid continuously. The dimension that are interesting, we suppose to have 7,000 tons in geostationary orbit, that compared to 420 tons that are the mass of the International Space Station in low Earth orbit, is a giant step ahead. The other solution is expect to have a mirror in space with a diameter of 2 kilometers and an altitude of more or less 1,000 kilometers far from Earth. This distance from Earth is justified by the fact that is to limit the spot on ground. In this case, the spot on ground is has a more or less 2 kilometer radius. We can also say that the reflected sunlight in this case is supposed to have the same intensity as daylight. But the scope of this presentation is not to provide technical detail on this system, even if they are interesting, since we are investigating the possibility, we are assessing the potentialities and the solution to be worked on. But is to understand how this, what are the implications of this huge structure in space, what could mean to have 7,000 tons in space. We have to leverage on technologies as in orbit assembly and potentially manufacturing. Here in this chart, we can summarize some project on this topic. And for example, the NASA OSAM-2 is together with Made in Space, that now is Redwire Corporation, is developing robotic technology to efficiently, autonomously manufacture and assemble hardware components and tools in space. other solution, Maxar, in partnership with NASA, developed the space infrastructure destro robot, Spider, that will demo orbit assembly and reconfiguration service on spacecraft component. And other other solution provided by DARPA and also European Space Agency with out-of-earth manufacturing, either on orbit or on the planet surface. Other other projects are is the Mirror, that is that allow to develop a multi-arm installation robot for on orbit on orbital replacement unit, and the Reflector. This movie show how this solution will be implemented to compose a mirror, an antenna in space. What we can say is that, as Arnaud Prost said in his very interesting presentation, what is the role of the man in this kind of endeavor? Arnaud said that human is always in the loop. I think that the position of the human in the loop is evolving. We started with the Space Hubble, or now, even if also now, in the International Space Station. We saw the video, the very interesting video, showed a few minutes ago. And you can see what are the challenges, the difficulties that an astronaut encounter in working in extravehicular activities. So why the man is used? Because the man is made to explore. We can say that is the nature of human to explore, but in the future we can change, as I said before, the position of the human in the loop, and using robot for example, maintenance operation, as it was for Space Hubble, is the future trend. Human can decide in situ and can face unexpected situation, but this solution also with the artificial intelligence can be also performed by a robot. But in any case, this is the future we are expecting, and is very, very interesting. Considering talking about in-orbit assembly manufacturing, we are proud as Thales Alenia Space to say that we provided almost half of the pressurized volume of the International Space Station that has been assembled in orbit. And you can see in this video how the Node 3 has been removed from the shuttle cargo bay together with cupola, and the cupola is relocated using the robotic arm in a different location. Cupola is used just for humans to monitor outside operation, and also for psychological reason to see outside. It is one of the main points considered important by the astronaut that spend long time in space. So another constraint is given by the launcher. Assembly manufacturing space help to overcome the constraint imposed by launcher. We can launch only what the launcher can host inside its fairing. So the possibility to assemble part in space, or also manufacturing, could be the solution for overcome this problem. So back to space-based solar power. other than technical issues, there are other risks like political, technological, economic, legal, social, environmental and safety, but no one of these problems represents a showstopper. Other solution, I see Stefan on my shoulder, to go quicker to the end. Other solution has been already developed around the world by NASA, by Japan, by China. But as Europe, Solaris was approved by his ministerial council in November 2022 with the aim of making Europe a key player and possibly a leader in the international race to develop clean and sustainable energy solution to attenuate the human-caused global warming. In the next phase, in the actual phase, the objective of Solaris is to determine benefit, technical feasibility, cost and risk, raise awareness of the solution among key stakeholders, establish opportunity for international cooperation, prepare proposal for development program, and position Europe as a serious player in space-based solar power. What can it be ready? In the 2040 goal is based on a business as usual funding and development profile, start with the ESA funding in 2023, then European funding injection around 2024 for the development program, in order to have an orbit demonstrator in 2030 and operational space-based power station in 2040-2050. In this, the actual project is that a couple of consortium has been awarded with the contract by ESA for developing, carrying a feasibility analysis on this project. The consortium is led by Thales Enea Space, that is a joint company between Thales and Leonardo, together with the Enel. And we will arrive to the end of this year for the first feasibility phase, for then continue the next phase in accord with the ESA roadmap. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much.